c'est juste de s'inspirer les uns des autres. C'est quelque chose qu'au Parti Vert Européen, nous commençons déjà à faire depuis quelques années. À chaque conseil, maintenant, on a des partis qui présentent leur stratégie électorale aux autres et à nous de nous en inspirer ou pas. Donc voilà, je voulais vraiment que ça soit très clair. Nous avons 4 intervenants avec nous. Ils viennent d'Autriche, de Finlande, des Pays-Bas et de Suisse. Et donc, je vais juste dire quelques mots à chaque fois sur chacun d'entre eux. Donc, on va commencer avec les Autrichiens. Pourquoi on commence avec les Autrichiens ? Parce que quelque part, c'est un petit peu eux qui ont ouvert la voie, puisque vous verrez après que Grünlinks, le Parti Vert des Pays-Bas, s'est beaucoup inspiré de l'Autriche. Donc, c'est un petit peu eux qui ont ouvert la voie. On va donc commencer avec eux. Le Parti Vert autrichien date de 1984. On est sur un système électoral de proportionnel, donc qui est un système avec une proportion à 2 niveaux, une proportion au niveau national et au niveau régional. Et donc, si vous n'avez pas réussi avec votre parti à avoir assez de voix au niveau régional, vous pouvez récupérer des voix sur votre moyenne nationale et remettre et vous retrouver avec à nouveau des élus. Quelques sièges au niveau national. Donc, vous voyez qu'on est très loin de notre système. On est dans un système à ce niveau-là plus favorable en ce qui concerne les élections nationales. Ceci étant dit, les Autrichiens, dans les années 90, rencontrent des difficultés. Ils voient une petite descente dans leur sondage, dans leur nombre de parlementaires. Et puis, ils décident, ils y réfléchissent beaucoup. Ils ont aussi un souci qu'on commence, nous, à connaître de plus en plus fortement. C'est évidemment le souci d'un parti d'extrême droite fort. Et donc, ils vont commencer à penser à implanter de manière très... Voilà, voulu penser une stratégie à partir de 2010. Et donc maintenant, je vais laisser notre invité vous présenter ça avec une présentation à l'appui. Et donc, 3 de nos intervenants parleront en anglais. Donc, Alberto, qui finira et qui est suisse, parlera en français. Vous pourrez enlever les casques à ce moment-là, mais pour les 3 prochains, ça sera en anglais. Go on, Georg.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Well, as you already said, that in 2010 we tried to change some things concerning the campaigns we did because we were at 10% on a national level then, but there was no further success. We lost 0.6% at the national election, and we had a new party leader, and we tried to change some things. And I will shortly present 10 rules we made up to you that might be of interest to you. The first rule is plan beats no plan. Sounds simple, but that's one of the main things. You need a good strategy. A strategy can be made in a big group, but you can't execute it in a big group. So you need to have a small group who does decisions within a campaign. That's one of the crucial points if you want to have success. I wrote another rule for you there. So don't try to be perfect, because trying to be perfect needs extreme energy, and you're gonna start from the beginning again if you are ready with the perfect plan. The second rule: don't try to fill every gap. Try to concentrate on some things, because the idea is to focus on things in a campaign and don't do everything, because you don't have the resources to do like radio spots, TV spots, everything. So for example, we focused on door-to-door campaigns. We focused on some goals, for example, to get a higher number of young voters, we, for example, focused on being as strong as the other parties concerning the poster campaign. The third rule is external beats internal. The Greens in Austria also had the tradition that we met in closed rooms with not a lot of voter contact. We put a lot of energy in, like we do here. Sure, you need that sometimes, but you should concentrate your resources on events where you meet voters. So. Don't use all your energy to discuss things you've already discussed within your party, and you don't get to know any other people. The fourth rule: we strongly recommend to focus on direct contact. That's something that's. For example, for the British Greens, that's normal because they couldn't get any votes without door-to-door campaigns. For us, it's quite new. Yeah, we did in Vienna alone. We did 100,000 door-to-door visits within the last election. So there's you can address voters in another way. Yeah, you can't control the media. You can't reach everybody with social media, but you can reach the people with door-to-door contact. Fifth rule: do the storytelling. If you don't have a story, people won't listen, and that's one thing. Which was crucial for winning the presidency with Alexander Van der Bellen, for example. We had a strong story from the beginning that had an hero in the story so all our people knew what to tell about our campaign. Do the framing is the sixth rule. So, what do I mean with framing? For example, if we use the wrong frame, we just help our opponents. For example, if we talk about refugee crisis or refugees. Pouring into our country or something like that. We use framings of the political opponent and only help them. And framing is hard work to do, and you need someone who is responsible for that. Try to get attention. This is, for example, a picture where you see the party leaders of the other parties, and it says more women to the top. It was featured brightly in many newspapers. So you have to try to get attention because you have small resources. So that's the coverage, for example, in this instance. Try to stay visible. For example, what we were using were tools that. That helped us to stay visible. We provided these bags that you see on the photo, and if you go through Vienna, you always will find someone with that bag. And there's even no green logo or something on that, but everybody knows it's from the Greens. Get some attention. This is what we see every day. A lot of different impressions. If we don't get the attention, if we don't focus on getting attention, we will won't be recognized. The ninth rule: work on your brand. Think about what you, how you want to be received by the people. Our brand in Austria is. Confident, courageous, and humorous, and everything we do has to be within everything we communicate has to be within these three words. you don't communicate the words, but still, here's an example of us being humorous. The Greens, we tended to be very serious and had the problem that that we took everything serious, and humor is a very good thing to do. Do the social media is the things once. I have how many time do I have left?
A few minutes.
Okay, then I will tell you something about the presidential campaign. We came from, as you know, we had a presidential campaign too. We came from 10%. That was what Van der Bellen did at his best national level election. I will skip that. And we had to do four campaigns within 1 year because of several problems within the election system. So we had 12 months of experience in campaigning last year. It was a difficult time. Brexit, Trump, refugees, terrorism. So it wasn't that easy to bring a green, a liberal candidate into presidency. I will tell you some succeeding factors. The first one was the person, the hero. Van der Bellen had a strong values. You could connect emotions, images, words to him. He was standing for hope, and that was the main story: hope versus fear, and community versus hatred. One succeeding factor is fuck the rules. So the Greens never tried to use the term Heimat. I don't know how to translate. It's like homeland. Yeah, it was something Greens never did before this campaign, in this campaign, we tried to redefine this term for our politics. So we also used the Austrian flag and such things, we redefined it. So our homeland is a homeland where there is no hatred, where there is no racism, where there is no division between different parts of the population. We strongly focused on the images we presented. There's some examples. We also tried to address the people outside the cities, and this was something which is very much in the pictures of Alexander Van der Bellen. I have some pictures. I will skip them now. But you see, we with the months we were patriotic more and more. So one succeeding factor that I want to mention is pace. Keep the opponent busy, or else they will keep you busy. Important for doing that is that you have that big decisions are made by a small number of people. So you have to be fast in a campaign. Then one succeeding factor was social media, which we talked on today already. We did one video a day, 226 in total, and we managed to, and we had a constant photographic documentation, and so we managed to get a high presence within the months. one last rule. Trial and error is a main rule. For example, we had a lot of videos that didn't work, but there was also, for example, one video with an old woman. She was a Holocaust survivor, and she was strongly recommending Van der Ben, and no one thought this video will work for a big number, but it worked for we had about 3.8 million views on Facebook alone then with it. So you have to try, and you have to try again. That's
it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, just go on. Maintenant, on va voir les Pays-Bas, Groenlinks. Alors, Groenlinks est né en 1989. Ils ont une grosse chute en 2012. Ils perdent trois quarts parlementaires. Oui, pardon, je parle sur le micro. Ils perdent trois quarts de leurs parlementaires. Ils ont vu venir. Ça fait un an qu'ils tombent dans les sondages. Donc déjà, avant ça, ils commencent à se poser des questions, mais ils vont au bout de cette campagne-là. Et ils vont, à partir de là, faire un gros moment de remise en cause et eux aussi retravailler leur stratégie jusqu'à à la victoire électorale dont vous avez peut-être entendu parler l'année très récemment en Hollande avec un leader qui s'appelle Jesse Klaver. Go on, Doug.
Thank you. The technique is working. So, welcome everyone. I will try to do as fast as I can. If it's too fast, then I will be here around after this meeting, so then I can repeat myself. I will see what time it is now, so I can also keep an eye on the time myself. Because I can talk for hours about strategy and campaign. So, we had a really successful campaign last March in the Netherlands, where we had our record ever in gaining seats and percentages in the national parliament, coming from our biggest loss ever in 2012, where we lost, of the 10 seats we had, we lost 6. So we didn't have much people left over, not in the parliament, but also not in our offices. So we had a hard time organizing it. But for this last campaign, we had quite a clear strategy. We wanted to have a positive and optimistic campaign for change. That was basically the main thing. We've put value central, and that were the three were fair share, empathy, and sustainability. The party characteristics, clear vigor, realism, and leadership had to improve. And what we would do would be huge, and we would prefer to do less things, but really, really good. And then Jesse, our party leader, was central in our campaign. We didn't use any other people in our campaign but Jesse, including really making a personality of him. So all his personal details were out on the streets, and well, he actually doesn't mind, and other politicians might be more reluctant to it, but he explained how he asked his wife to marry him and all those stories on television, and it worked out well. We focus on a grassroots campaign and doing lots of door-to-door campaigning, which was also in the Netherlands very, very unusual, but we did it, and we now have the result, and we can see per city and per voting box where we scored the best, and we can really see wherever we have done door-to-door campaigning, we've won more than on average. So I would very much recommend it. Then the campaign was mainly online, and that was also because we just didn't have any budget whatsoever, and online was the cheapest, basically. And we've put lots of energy in the so-called meetups that we had in several towns in pop venues. We would have an evening with our party leader, some musicians, a columnist, and lots of happy, jolly people. And this was all leading to a movement of people that were supporting us in winning the elections, well, or gaining seats in parliament, because of course we didn't win the elections because the Liberals did, but we had at least our personal record. So how to build a movement? What we try to do. Well, this is a letter of engagement that we try to put together. So first of all, you need to create awareness, which we did online. We were the largest, we had the largest online reach of all parties. Most of our videos had over 1 million views, and in a country of 15 million inhabitants, that's of course quite a lot. And with that awareness, you want to acquire potential voters and interest of people. And also, we had the most likes, the most mentions, the most hashtags were for our party. And through that, we can activate people. And we had more than 10,000 volunteers in the Netherlands, coming from absolutely zero. And we got all those people to come to those meetups. And through this activation, you can again acquire more likes, more mentions, etc. And those who then still can't get enough, they will really become activists and start to crowdfund, doing the door-to-door campaigning and being a so-called aptivist, which was a word that we have invented, that we could... we had a group of people in WhatsApp, 5,000, and if we wanted to get something viral, we could ask them to help us out to share something within an hour, and that way we were really quick in getting lots of likes and mentions, etc., on social media. And what was important, that we always had a call to action in all our emails, tweets, Facebook posts, and everything. We always asked personally to people, can you please do something? Give money, like, share, come to a place, or whatever we wanted to have them to do. So the basis for our success was research. When we were hitting rock bottom in 2012, we decided, well, already before, because we saw it coming, we decided to do proper research on our electorate. And I will go through the different types of research that we did. First of all, we do a yearly quantitative research. I think the Austrians do the same thing, which is a very big research for all voters in the Netherlands, and we look in which values are pooling or pushing voters, our own performance on certain values and issues, how volatile is our potential voter, how much known are our politicians, what issues are the most important, all those kind of things. And we do it every year so we can compare from year to year if we are improving. And that was very important to convince the rest of the party. We have our own panel. Through petitions and all that, we get contact details of people that are interested in our party, not necessarily voters, and we ask them if they want to become a member of our own panel. And with those panels, we can just do quick checks on opinion polling or testing a frame or testing a poster and all those kind of things. Then thirdly, we do focus groups. So we have a group of people with potential voters sitting behind a glass. They can't see us. They don't know that we are actually the ones that are paying for it. Well, they hear at the end, of course, and they talk for a couple of hours about issues that we want them to discuss about. And we do that with potential voters of people that in research have said that they don't vote green, but they would consider voting green. And we test frames, we see what are our hidden opportunities, what the look and feel is of our party, and we get really good insights in how, in general thoughts of the public on how they look at the politics and at our party. In 2012, I did this the first time. It was absolutely awful, because I had to watch for 2 days to people who were complaining about us and saying how terrible we were. The last time I did it, it was just one big joy. Because when we said at the end, well, actually, the ones that wanted to know your opinion was GroenLinks, they were all like, oh, great, can we meet them? So that was nice. So, and the fourth one is political research. So that's just someone sitting in behind a computer with lots of books, like myself, and just reading and reading and doing many, many interviews with all kinds of politicians throughout Europe to find out what is exactly the driving factor why they won elections. So we've been looking into the Austrian campaign, into the German, and, well, many different campaigns, many interviews, and that's how we sort of got to a way how we think we should communicate, and especially how we should frame. And the conclusion of this was that we should do positive framing. So many people always ask me, how do you convince the others the way you're doing campaign? And that is this research. I mean, if you do the research and you follow the conclusions, because a lot of Greens do research and they leave it at the Heinrich Böll Stiftung or whatever department they have, and they all say, yeah, that is indeed very, very interesting, isn't it? And maybe we should also present it somewhere. Yes, and then it's over. We actually follow the conclusions, go back to it. Are we doing it the right way? Is it working? And continue this research and share the results with our politicians, our campaign leaders, and we do it again and again and again, because then they can see that there's a result, and then you can also see that it actually makes sense to have a central-led campaign. Because before, and you probably have that at many different green parties, all cities say, no, we are different than the others, we will use our own material, etc., etc. We don't have that anymore, and that's really thanks to research. And remember, it's better to have a good tested flyer or message than loads of shitty flyers that nobody cares about. So rules in positive messaging for us is that we ignore losses. If we lose a vote or we lose a certain thing that we really wanted to get, forget about it, let's continue. Do not start communicating about how awful all the others are, just ignore it. Secondly, don't fight your friends and stay friendly. Even if they are so evil, don't call them idiots. Don't say that Le Pen is a Nazi or a fascist or whatever. Just stay friendly and stick to your own message. And with your own friends, like social democrats and all those kind of people, how much they attack you, just stay friendly and don't get into this fight, because it won't help you. Well, frame positively, I've said that before, and make people part of your message. Really make sure that to who you are communicating, that they are really getting something back and giving something back, and they feel part of your movement. And last but not least, show results and celebrate them. When we win a vote, for example, in European Parliament, where I work, I always see that we have these really neutral press releases of the Green Group, for example, that say the European Parliament has decided to agree upon blah, blah, blah. Well, it's actually our own report, and so we should cheer and we should celebrate each other, just like footballers do. This one was especially for Yannick Jadot, actually, but I think he's not in the room, which is a shame. But as a big Paris Saint-Germain fan, he would appreciate this. So our analysis of green framing, or my analysis, actually, main pitfalls, I will just go quickly through them, considering time. Finger pointing, we do it always. They're wrong, they're bad, they're awful, they're fascist and idiots, and etc. It won't help. Nobody thinks you're a nice guy. Christmas trees, we want to do something, and then we build a Christmas tree. Is it in France also Christmas trees? Okay, good. So Christmas trees. I have two kids, so when I build a Christmas tree, my daughter wants to have a pink ball, and my son wants to have a blue one, and my wife wants some silver ones. And before you know it, you have this awful Christmas tree. They all like it because they see their own ball in there. But if you're an outsider, you think, who made this? And that is usually how we work as Greens. So we have someone of the gay rights, someone of the animal rights, someone of the women rights, someone of the climate, someone of the I don't know what, and we build this Christmas tree and nobody knows what we're talking about. They just think, wow, that's a mess. Third, I know a lot, don't I? That's another typical Green thing. We are in a debate on radio or on television and we really want to show that we know everything, all percentages, everything, everything, everything. And we forget to talk about values and about why we actually want something. Then nagging, that's what we're really, really good at. So the European Commission finally has some ambitious goals on climate. And what do we say? Oh, finally, the European Commission also understands it. Instead, we should say, yay, we won. We convinced the European Commission, but we don't. So we always have this yes, but, that's the following one, that we all say, yeah, that's a good proposal, but it's not good enough. And that way, you don't get people along in that you're actually having success and they want to join you. And the last one, you probably have already read. And if you didn't, that's a shame, because we're at the next one. So positive frames, words matter. Clean energy versus dirty energy. We did really a lot of research on wording. And we were always using in the Netherlands the words dirty energy. Stop dirty energy. We want clean energy. And we figured out that every time when we said dirty energy, we were actually losing voters. So we quit that. We only talk about clean energy. And then it works. So always the positive side of a negative thing. Say what you want to achieve and not what you want to stop. There's a picture in there, in defense of freedom against illiberal democracies, which was a thing in Liverpool of the EGP. So we're telling what we want and what we don't want. The result was that in the panel, everybody was talking about what they didn't want. So they were against Putin, they were against the Polish government, they were against Trump, they were against Geert Wilders and Marine Le Pen. They were all awful. Nobody in this three-hour session, it was, I think, talked about in defense of freedom, what is actually our message. And then last one, if you really don't know any way to frame it positively, then at least do it tongue in cheek. And then usually they ask me, what is tongue in cheek? So now I put a gif with that. That's tongue in cheek, more or less. So it's ironic, etc. Then dare to dream. How am I with time, Gwen?
Not much, but
okay. I will talk even quicker. So dare to dream. Create a world where you want to live in. That's very important. Speak to desire instead of reason. We always try to convince people with reason, and then this is usually what other people think. And be aware that the general public only sees 1 minute of your total campaign. So hold a high standard and make thumb-stopping content. Here are three pictures. One of Austria. They are really good in using humor and creating this world where you want to live in. You saw it with the pictures of Van der Bellen in nature, just what you want to do. We try to do the same thing in the Netherlands, which is the one on the right-hand side. It was not that successful. But I compare it with Coca-Cola ads. Coca-Cola doesn't say, do you want a very cold drink with lots of sugar and caffeine? No. They have a picture of two girls on the roof. It's probably hot. Otherwise, they would wear much more, I think. And they're having a Coca-Cola. And that's just, they are really selling a feeling. And that's actually their slogan, taste the feeling. So, content versus party characteristics. I'm almost done, Gwen. Just to show you something of the research that we've done. I can explain a lot about this picture, but what you should know is that we've scored all kinds of content and issues. And what is in the green circle are the motivators for voters. And we do this per party, per potential voters, etc. And what we see everywhere is that hardly any of the issues is a motivator for voters. Although they say themselves, oh, for me, environment is really important. But if you really do good research, you see it's not. Because what's more important is the party characteristics. And you see that here in the motivators with, again, a green thing. And there you see all the characteristics of the party. They are all in the motivating corner. This is one of some years ago when we were doing really, really bad. So we had to improve those. And for us, that was that we should be clear, show vigor, show leadership, and maintain realism. And we did that throughout the years, and we can see the result, because here are strengths and weaknesses. And you see that in 2015, we were scoring a lot less than in 2016. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Gert.
Emma est la directrice de campagne du parti finlandais. Les Finlandais sont nés en 1987. Aux élections parlementaires de 2011, ils ont une grosse chute. Et ils perdent beaucoup de leurs sièges. Ils sont extrêmement déçus du résultat. Et de la même manière, ils vont implanter à partir de là des stratégies. Ils avaient notamment l'habitude de beaucoup combattre et de beaucoup parler d'un parti qui s'appelait les Two Finns, qui est l'équivalent de notre Front National. Ils en ont conclu que c'était peut-être pas une bonne solution de tout le temps parler d'eux, qu'il ferait mieux de parler d'eux-mêmes. Et ils sont aujourd'hui en train de dans les sondages, d'être à 12,5% au dernier sondage durant cet été. C'est aujourd'hui notre parti qui, dans les sondages, fait le meilleur résultat en Europe. Et pour ceux qui auraient oublié aussi, il y a quelques années, ils ont eux aussi failli gagner le président de la Finlande. Ils ont eu un candidat qui est arrivé au second tour.
Okay. Hi, I'm Emma Mikkila from Finland, from Finnish Greens. I think this is not the best possible, but I think it's good enough. Or can you see it properly?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I am a campaign coordinator in the Finnish Greens. Thank you for inviting me here. It's very nice always to see and meet international friends and other Greens from other parts of Europe. So where to start? Actually, Gwen told already a lot of background. We were very disappointed after 2011 parliamentary elections, and but we learned a lot from that campaign also. As Gwen told you, we learned that we shouldn't waste our energy to talk about others. We shouldn't talk about other parties' politics. We should concentrate on our message and make our message as clear as possible. So instead of talking about others, we were trying to talk about our own solutions. Austrian Greens were very inspirational for us as well. A lot of our people met Austrian people, and actually it was quite interesting to see about the campaign in Netherlands that used very, very similar things that I'm going to present here. So maybe I can be a little bit briefer here, since many things are in some point similar. So this is the story behind our local election campaign. The elections were a couple of months ago, so not very far away from here. Based on what we learned in 2011 elections, we formed our strategy again for 2015 parliamentary elections, and we used very similar messages in local election campaign in 2017. For example, our messages were very similar as in 2015. For example, the main topics were the same. Here we have our main posters of the campaign, and you can see the main topics over there: schools, environment, and work, and then fighting poverty. So we used very similar topics in the 2017 election campaign, since the topics were still very, very well, it fits very well in the discussion what was going on in our society. But one of the main things behind our campaign was what was also happened in Netherlands, that we actually used researches to know who our potential voters actually are. We stopped guessing and we focused on actually knowing who are these people, what are their worries, how do they spend their time, how can we reach them, or how do they see the things from their own perspectives. So we stopped guessing. We had been guessing all the time. We thought we know who they are, but actually we found out that not our potential voters are always similar to us, because we are the most interested about our own politics, so we shouldn't consider it like everyone is so interested about our politics. So we took a lot of time and effort to know who our potential voters are. And we rethought how to communicate with the potential voters. Ideas about visual images, tone, and emotional content of the campaign were developed and rethought. We really invested in communications. I'm sorry, the picture doesn't look as good, but if maybe that's fine. The main idea in our campaign was to offer solutions. We discussed and we criticized, but we also wanted to offer solutions. Of course, we commented if another party made a suggestion, but we always took it back to our own solutions, our own ideas. We wanted to offer our solutions and not to talk about others. Our campaigns were positive. Visual materials felt positive, warm, optimistic. We wanted to offer hope, a good future, and we sincerely thought that these are the politics that would make our country and the world a better place. We wanted to include the voter in our message. We wanted to talk to you personally, to you, and not only about us, the Greens, somewhere over there. So we managed to build a coherent, a positive campaign, and to give concrete solutions. But we were also brief and understandable. At least that was what we wanted to be. We tried to talk the same language as the voters. We realized that many of our potential voters may feel politics as very distant and not related to their own daily lives. And we decided to be more understandable. We didn't talk about structures of the society, like educational system. Instead, we started to talk about concrete things, like schools and teachers and children at school or so on. Like things that everybody understand and things that concern our daily lives. I also have some single examples of campaign actions, what we did, if we have some time more. Okay, the first example is bus tour, what we did around the country. This was the Austrians' idea, and we stole it, thank you. and it worked very, very well. For 1 month, Greens were everywhere, in small cities, small towns. We managed to be present in smaller cities and areas that hadn't been used to see Greens in their streets. Earlier we were more, our image was more that we succeed in bigger cities, in university cities, but the bus tour, the idea behind the bus tour was that we want to be present, we want to be in these smaller cities and towns. And really, we succeeded to be present in different corners of the country. The second example is a picture of how we discovered to use location-based Facebook advertising. This was during the time of advance voting, when anyone can vote in any polling station of the country. The idea behind location-based advertising is that on Facebook, stores and shops can advert the closest shop to a Facebook user using the location information of the Facebook user. In our case, the locations were the nearest polling stations to the Facebook user, and so the idea was that when Facebook users saw the advertisement, it told the currently closest polling station in the map and the opening hours, as well as reminded to go to vote. And it said, it's very easy to vote, you can do it here, and you only need your IDs. And it says, I already voted, and now I'm having a coffee, and I'm so happy. and finally, here I have a picture of our webpage. I mean, like an extra program for the candidates of our local elections. The candidates could go and produce their own campaign material for social media in this webpage. You can, it's programmed so that when you go to this webpage and when you have the password, that obviously we didn't want to get to give it to anyone else than our candidates. When you go to that webpage, you can download your own picture and write your own text, and it automatically includes our slogan and logo and makes the picture look as part of our campaign. So it was quite an impressive tool. You can imagine when 2,600 Green candidates use the similar kind of pictures in Facebook, it looks quite good actually. And it was very easy for the candidates to produce visual material for Facebook or social media. Okay, so here was a brief story of our campaign. I hope you found it inspirational, and I hope I didn't take too much time.
No, that's fine, thanks. Okay, Albert. Pour que vous puissiez avoir le temps pour des questions, on va tout de suite continuer avec Alberto, donc du Parti Suisse. Parti qui a été créé en 1983, il y a eu un moment difficile entre 2011 et fin 2015, avec un fort recul électoral, et c'est depuis 2011 et 2012 que des mesures ont été prises pour chercher à y remédier. J'ai oublié de le dire pour les Finlandais, mais je vais le dire pour le Suisse. Le système suisse est à la proportionnelle pour différents niveaux qui sont confédération, canton, commune et les élections législatives. Mais par contre, c'est majoritaire pour d'autres élections. Et pour les Finlandais, c'est un système tellement compliqué que je ne prendrai pas le temps de vous l'expliquer maintenant, mais qui n'est pas un système complètement proportionnel.
Là, vous pouvez enlever les casques parce qu'Alberto parlera en français.
Avec un accent suisse, mais je suis sûr que vous allez le comprendre. Les.
Now, shall you go to the play button?
Yeah. This one?
And then click and don't click on the left hand side.
Which one?
Well, now this you should get rid of it.
Et voilà. Alors. Bonjour tout le monde. Tout d'abord, merci beaucoup aux organisatrices et organisateurs pour l'invitation. C'est toujours très agréable de pouvoir rencontrer des Verts d'autres pays et discuter. Comme cela a été dit, les Verts suisses, effectivement, ont pas mal progressé ces derniers temps, après une période de vache maigre, ou tofu maigre, devrait-on dire, enfin, pour être plus poétiquement correct, mais on va mieux, enfin, on a perdu pas mal de plumes lors des élections fédérales de 2011 et 2015, mais depuis il y a eu un changement de situation qui est dû bien entendu en partie à des facteurs qu'on ne maîtrise pas forcément, enfin, le contexte international, la situation économique et plein d'autres choses, mais aussi, on l'imagine et on aime à le penser en tout cas, à un certain nombre de mesures qui ont été prises par les Verts à tous les niveaux, que ce soit au niveau suisse, enfin donc au niveau fédéral, ou au niveau des sections locales, parce qu'on a effectivement en Suisse, et je vais y revenir, un système fédéral qui fait que on a une certaine marge de manœuvre, disons, à tous les niveaux institutionnels, ce qui n'est pas forcément le cas partout. Donc on a un parti national, mais aussi des sections cantonales, donc l'équivalent des départements, toute proportion gardée, qui ont une grande marge de manœuvre et qui parfois suivent des stratégies, des lignes de communication qui ne sont pas celles du parti central, disons. Voilà, là c'est pour la minute de chauvinisme, les sièges qu'on a pu remporter. Pour la première fois, il y a notamment un maire écologiste de la ville de Berne, qui est la capitale fédérale, donc c'est quand même pas mal. Et pour la première fois depuis 8 ans, on voit aussi que les sondages donnent les Verts en progression comme 5e, voire 4e parti du pays. Donc à la proportionnelle, c'est pas mal, ça nous permet de pouvoir imaginer gagner quelques sièges aux prochaines élections fédérales qui sont en 2019. Il faut savoir aussi, c'est important de le dire, qu'en Suisse, on a la particularité, qui est presque unique au monde, à ma connaissance, il y a uniquement à ce niveau-là certains États des États-Unis, qui ont un vrai système de démocratie directe. C'est-à-dire qu'en Suisse, on peut, moyennant le suivi de certaines règles, faire des propositions, un certain nombre de citoyens peuvent faire des propositions qui sont ensuite soumises au vote. Et donc on vote en Suisse 4 à 5 fois par année, au niveau fédéral, puis aussi au niveau local. En gros, il faut récolter 100 000 signatures de citoyennes ou citoyens suisses ayant le droit de vote au niveau fédéral. Et on peut ensuite faire une proposition sur un texte X ou Y qui modifie la Constitution. Et ça, on l'a beaucoup mis en œuvre dès 2011-2012. Il y a eu deux initiatives qui ont été lancées par les Verts. Une première qui s'appelle pour une économie verte, qui demandait à ce que le système de production, enfin le système économique suisse, se réoriente vers plus de durabilité, avec notamment le principe d'économie circulaire, etc. Et une autre qui demandait à ce qu'on sorte définitivement du nucléaire avec des délais de X années pour la fermeture des centrales nucléaires. C'est un système qui est relativement lent, hein. On est Suisse, donc tout prend un petit peu de temps. En l'occurrence, ces deux initiatives, on a récolté les signatures nécessaires en 2011, et il y a toute une phase parlementaire ensuite de discussion, etc. Elles ont été soumises au vote populaire en 2016, tant l'une que l'autre, et ça a véritablement amené des thèmes écologistes sur le devant de la scène, parce qu'il faut imaginer qu'à chaque fois qu'il y a une votation, bah, les médias parlent énormément de ces sujets, on a des débats, des campagnes d'affichage, etc. En l'occurrence, ni l'une ni l'autre n'ont passé la rampe du peuple, c'est très rare hein, qu'une initiative passe, malheureusement c'est que les initiatives xénophobes qui sont acceptées par le peuple, mais celles écologistes pas encore, on y travaille, mais ça a quand même permis de véritablement mettre sur le devant de la scène des thématiques comme celle effectivement, de l'économie durable, de la sortie du nucléaire, que jusque-là le thème principal de la politique suisse, c'était les politiques migratoires, la fermeture des frontières, etc. Donc, on a réussi à mettre l'écologie sur le devant de la scène, et le parti qui a la meilleure expertise, d'après les électrices et électeurs, en matière d'écologie, c'est les Verts. Donc, ça nous a pas mal aidés. On a été aussi un petit peu aidés par un parti de droite populiste qui s'appelle UDC, qui a lancé un référendum contre un projet de loi assez consensuel hein, et pas folichon non plus, sur la, qui s'appelle Stratégie énergétique 2050, qui vise à développer les énergies renouvelables et à sortir justement à trop long terme, d'après nous, mais quand même, du nucléaire. Ce parti a dit non, c'est pas bien, ça va être mauvais pour l'économie, les énergies renouvelables, on s'en fiche. Je caricature, mais c'était un petit peu ça quand même leur message. Et ça a permis là aussi de parler énormément de questions énergétiques. Et là encore, celles et ceux qui ont la meilleure expertise en la matière, qui étaient le plus interviewés par les différents médias, enfin qui ont réussi à mieux faire passer leur message, c'était les Verts. Donc la démocratie directe nous a beaucoup aidés en ce sens-là. On a réussi à remettre l'écologie sur le devant de la scène et en faire un vrai thème politique en Suisse ces deux dernières années, et ça continue parce qu'aussi au niveau local, par exemple dans le canton d'où je viens, le canton de Vaud, on a lancé une initiative pour interdire l'extraction de gaz de schiste, et on a fait un tabac, on a récolté les signatures en pleine campagne électorale pour les votations régionales, et ça a très très bien marché, ça nous a donné un thème de campagne, et là encore, c'est devenu un thème sur lequel les autres partis ont dû se positionner, dire ce qu'ils en pensaient, et celles et ceux qui avaient un discours le plus cohérent, disons, et crédible, c'était les Verts. Donc voilà, la démocratie directe, c'est quelque chose de très suisse, c'est pas forcément transplantable à une réalité française ou autre pays européen, mais quand même, je pense que le fait de réussir à remettre sur le devant de la scène les thèmes dans lesquels on est le plus crédible et les plus forts, plutôt que d'essayer de se positionner sur les thèmes des autres, comme ça a été dit avant, c'est un point important. Une autre chose qui a été importante, c'est que les Verts ont été, ces derniers mois, présenté comme étant le parti de l'antipopulisme, en quelque sorte. Enfin, il y a un important journal en Suisse allemande, le principal journal suisse, qui a titré « Sind die Grüne die Anti-Trump-Partei », ce qui veut dire « Les Verts sont-ils le parti anti-Trump ?» Et après, l'article répondait par l'affirmative en disant que oui, effectivement, de par leur message clair, de par la non-volonté de faire de la... la lutte contre la polémique stérile, etc., les messages sérieux que développent les Verts, on nous a considérés comme les anti-Trump. Après, voilà, c'est peut-être pas pertinent de reparler de Trump. Là, en l'occurrence, c'est un journal qui l'a fait. Mais ce qui est déterminant, à mon sens, là-dedans, c'est que véritablement, il y a une part de l'électorat en Suisse, mais je pense aussi ailleurs, en Europe et dans le monde, qui n'a pas envie de messages à l'emporte-pièce, de slogans faciles, de « il n'y a qu'à faire ceci, il n'y a qu'à faire cela », mais qui veut des réponses un petit peu plus structurées, même si des fois elles sont un peu plus compliquées, à problèmes complexes, réponses pas forcément simples, mais il y a une part de l'électorat qui est prête à entendre cela et qui demande justement quelque chose d'un petit peu plus clair, sérieux. Sérieux, ça ne veut pas dire austère, hein. On s'est aussi beaucoup inspiré de la communication des Verts autrichiens, par exemple, et on fait des choses assez drôles sur les réseaux sociaux notamment, mais jamais avec des messages simplistes. On essaie toujours d'avoir un message qui... Alors je pense qu'on pêche un petit peu parfois par trop d'intellectualisme, mais on gagnerait à simplifier un petit peu nos messages, mais on a quand même des messages qui sont clairs et des positions qui sont profilées, fortes et vraiment argumentées. Ça, je pense que c'est quand même très important. Et ça nous a permis justement, là encore, d'être sur le devant de la scène et d'amener des fois un message aussi d'expert. Enfin, en matière de politique climatique, par exemple, on a chez nous des personnes qui sont des spécialistes, des scientifiques ou autres, et voilà, c'est un discours d'expert. Là encore, je pense qu'il faut faire attention à ne pas sombrer dans l'élitisme, donc c'est délicat, mais le message a pour l'heure bien passé. Et voilà, une autre chose importante, c'est l'action participative pour imaginer l'écologie politique de demain. On a lancé ces derniers mois un vaste programme de discussion, les débats verts, avec nos membres, pour voir sur quels thèmes doivent se positionner les Verts à l'avenir, de quelle manière, avec quel message. Et c'est extrêmement enrichissant et on voit que ça motive aussi les membres. De ne pas juste avoir un message qui leur est délivré du haut et qu'on leur demande ensuite de transmettre, mais de pouvoir vraiment participer à la création de ce message et de ces thématiques. Et on s'est aussi positionné sur des questions de niche, entre guillemets, mais qui viennent sur le devant de la scène et que les autres partis n'ont pas encore vraiment exploité, sur lesquelles les autres partis n'ont pas encore de discours. Je pense par exemple à la question de l'éthique animale, enfin la bien-traitance animale, etc. C'est un sujet qui devient de plus en plus important en Suisse parce qu'il y a eu divers cas de maltraitance, enfin d'élevage qui ne respectaient pas les règles avec des images assez affreuses. Et nous, ça fait un certain temps, tant au niveau local qu'au niveau suisse, qu'on a un discours là-dessus, qu'on demande que les choses soient améliorées, que les normes en matière d'élevage soient améliorées, etc. Et on a beaucoup parlé des Verts et de leur position dernièrement parce qu'on est les seuls à avoir un discours construit vraiment en la matière. Donc voilà un petit peu, après il y aurait la question des réseaux sociaux, etc. Mais je crois que j'ai épuisé mon temps de parole assez largement. Donc voilà, merci.
Merci. Je vous propose de prendre 20 minutes pour des questions et des réponses. Morgan, can you give the mic? Donc voilà, un micro va circuler. Donc on va commencer avec la demoiselle là, et puis j'ai vu une autre main là-bas, voilà. Donc.
So in the middle there, and then the man on the front row. I've got two questions. Did you have to redefine your identity as Greens and become a bit more centrist in order to win a new electorate and to win the elections? And secondly, there's a discussion in France if we need left-winged populism. And do you think your communication strategies is populist in the sense that you speak the language of the people and that you, that you campaign on the issues that are important to the people, not your own identity as Greens.
Okay. I propose we take 3 questions, okay, and then I make you... second one here, Morgan, and then we had one there. Et après on fera un deuxième... Voilà, deuxième rangée de 3 là, d'accord.
Oui, moi, c'est une question concernant les organes de direction de vos partis, c'est-à-dire les instances nationales. Est-ce qu'elles sont homogènes, est-ce qu'elles sont globalement d'accord, ou est-ce que, comme en France, on a un peu des tendances et rien que dans nos instances nationales, des visions différentes, par exemple sur les alliances avec les autres partis ou pas, et éventuellement les positionnements sur, l'échiquier politique.
And last one there.
Merci. Merci à vous d'avoir partagé tout ça. C'est une question qui est vraiment dans la foulée de ce qui vient d'être dit. J'ai envie de poser sur une forme de boutade. Quand est-ce que vous avez organisé votre congrès dans tout ça ? Plus sérieusement, est-ce que vous avez préalablement défini collectivement des stratégies et ensuite vous avez mis des candidats pour les porter ? Ou est-ce qu'il y a eu une direction politique portée avec des gens, par exemple Van der Bellen, en disant « je serai le candidat » et que c'est lui ou les candidats qui ont ensuite impulsé ces stratégies de communication. C'est-à-dire dans quel sens est-ce que vous avez fonctionné ? Merci.
So now I will give you a few minutes each. So to recall, we have three questions. The first one was mostly also to know if you. Je me rappelle plus de la première partie de ta question. Excuse-moi, avant le populisme de gauche. Ah oui. So did you have to redefine your identity to be more centrist or on the opposition? Are you thinking about this idea of a left-wing populism? The second one was about have you got dissensions in your governance board and all of this? And this that means that they're fighting together about alliances. And then the third one was: is it more the candidates that impulse the campaigns, or the campaigns and then the candidates fits the campaign? Let's just do it in order. Go on, Dirk, you can start.
Is it working, this one? Yeah, it is. So concerning the first question, we didn't get more centrist at all. We got more left-wing, I think, actually, during the campaign. And I mean, it's very important to show your ideals, but at the same time be realistic and that you can always explain, okay, this is what we want, but we will have to compromise if we will be in a government. Especially on climate, but also on social side of the whole story, we were very left-wing and we didn't go more centrist. It's a typical thing in the Netherlands that if you have an electoral program, then independently the government goes through the program and will say how much it will cost, how much employment, etc., etc. And we're doing really bad with that, really good with that one. So we could explain all the time, well, you know, it's independently is proven that our radical ideas are good. Concerning language, yes, indeed, in that sense you could call us populist, that we wouldn't, that we would really talk language on street level, basically. But I wouldn't call us populist in a sense that we would be angry at all kinds of things and saying all kinds of crazy things and being against all kinds of stuff. But indeed, we were really, the way Jesse did all his speeches was really understandable language. So in that sense, a populist, yes. The second question is more about internal stuff, of course. What was good in our parties that we all agreed, but well, that was after long research. I mean, throughout the years, of course, we also had all these fights. But what I also see a lot is that what I understand a little bit of the question is that there's also you should have consensus on the content of the of what you're striving for. And I think that is one of the main things that we've learned, that it's about, if you want to win those elections, you shouldn't discuss all the content. Well, you should, of course, have content, but you should mainly agree on the values and how to improve those values. And then you can work on improving the whole world, basically, because you get enough seats. And that knowledge is now really widely spread in our party. And still, of course, people disagree, and that's all fine. But it's also quite clear that at a certain moment a decision is being taken, and that's done by the party leader, the head of the party, campaign leader, online campaigner during the campaigns. And that's it. And there's no discussion. Well, not a public discussion, at least. We really managed to get the public discussion out. The last question was about how to decide upon the candidate. Well, in our case, when we lost the election in 2012, the party leader, who was then party leader, stepped down, and we got a sort of in-between party leader. And he managed to get the party back in a sort of rest mode, and we wouldn't be fighting all the time whose fault it was that we lost the elections. And then he was also looking for a new leader, and that was Jesse, and he was already in the parliament. And he indeed also asked other people that are important in our party if they would want to compete him. But everybody sort of agreed on, okay, it should be him. And then we have our forced by our members that we always have a referendum. So then we had a referendum, but nobody dared to compete with Jesse. So he became party leader. And since then, it was a sort of a structure that was just very naturally with all the people building this campaign that fit him and that also fit the party.
Yeah, just to go a bit further, is the campaign is shaped around Jesse?
Yeah, so yeah, absolutely.
The campaign is shaped around Jesse. So, is the personality of Jesse and yeah, who he is also influencing the campaign? Do you use him?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Also?
Yeah, no. I mean, the campaign was all around Jesse. I mean, also the whole movement and those meetups we had. About 70% of the people that were showing up at those events were not a member of our party, for example. But the way we now communicate as a whole, as a in the party, so also other politicians, is following the same strategy. So it's empathy. It's well, all those values that I mentioned in my presentation. So we all try to communicate in the same way. We do it in the European Parliament, we do it in the Senate, we try to do it at national level, at local level. That is more or less the way we communicate. So in that sense, it is now also the brand of our party. What is something what the Austrians did really well is really trying to get this brand out, and that's now what we're trying to hold on to.
Okay, Georg.
Did we get more center? I don't think so. We also didn't get more left as you did, but still, I think we stayed with our party identity, but we concentrated on certain topics and values and didn't do everything we did before, at least in public. I don't think we are going to be a left wing populism movement. I think it's we are being clearer in our message sometimes, but there is nothing the Greens in Austria are doing which has no backing in our programs and so on. Consensus. I don't know if I understood the question right, because if it's consensus about the new strategy, the new communication, the new form of communication, there is a big consensus within the party, but there was also resistance every time we changed something. So we also had these flyers that were different in every local group, and we managed to get one appearance, for example, and that was. It was the work of 2 years or something like that, yeah. But and success that was something that helped us with implementing such things. So after the first success appeared, it was easier to do the reforms. But I also have to say we now face. Quite difficult conflict with a member of parliament which now runs another party against us. This has nothing to do with the strategy in the communication strategy, but with other things, because he didn't get elected internally, and that's something that's really difficult for us in October. So I guess you won't invite us within the next 4 years, because we will be at in another low for in October, I guess. So at least we have a difficult situation for this campaign. And the last thing, candidate and strategy, we always build the strategy around and the story around the candidate. So for sure there is there is some reasons why we choose a candidate, but we don't make up the story and then choose the candidate for the stories. That's what I wanted to say.
It's the contrary. Yeah. Okay, you choose the candidate, then you go with the story that goes with it. Okay.
But normally we choose people that are somehow green, so somehow our story will fit with the candidate.
Yes, hopefully. Okay.
No, we didn't have to change ourselves for this campaign. And actually, I don't think we would have win if we would have changed our identity for an election campaign. Actually, I think we, in what we managed to do was that for the first time, we succeeded in talking people like in a way that they understand it. In Finland, we call populism as a very, very different kind of politics. We don't talk about our politics as populism. We do offer solutions. We understand that they are not always simple, but we offer realistic solutions that we have calculated the numbers very carefully. We have science based on our solutions. They're not like easy strategies coming from our minds or something like that, but we really carefully build our messages and our solutions. And no, we didn't have to change our politics. What we did was to include people's daily lives in our politics and speak it in a way that people understand us. It doesn't have to be populism if I want to speak about schools, for example, and many things in our daily lives are the actual things that we do in politics, and it doesn't always need to be very high-end discussion about the structures. It can be very, very concrete examples about daily lives. What else? Maybe I'm talking too much. About the campaigns, about the candidates, for example, we had in our local elections, we had 2,600 candidates, so obviously we couldn't control what our candidates did. We chose candidates that were green, that shared our values, and we trained them. We told them that our campaign will be positive, our campaign messages will be these, and we hope that you can join us in our common campaign. So
that's it?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Alors, pour ce qui est du centrisme, il faut savoir qu'en Suisse, au début des années 2000, il y a eu une scission du Parti des Verts. Et il y a un parti qui s'appelle les Verts libéraux qui s'est créé, qui est un parti de centre-droit qui diffère de l'écologie. Enfin, c'est un peu les Républicains qui posent des panneaux solaires, enfin, pour un petit peu... Ouais. Enfin, donc, c'est pas très crédible, mais disons que c'est un parti qui a réussi à se positionner dans l'échiquier politique et qui a une part d'électorat. Ce qui a fait aussi qu'un certain nombre de personnes qui avaient un profil plus centriste ont quitté les Verts... et sont aujourd'hui chez les Verts libéraux. Donc on a clairement un positionnement plutôt à gauche, même s'il y a un spectre après relativement large. Et plutôt que faire du populisme de gauche, ce qu'on essaye de faire, c'est de se positionner très clairement sur certains thèmes précis. Par exemple, dépénalisation du cannabis, on a une politique aussi très offensive contre les dépenses militaires. On a lancé un référendum contre l'achat d'avions de combat qu'on a remporté. Enfin, c'est, c'est la première fois qu'on gagnait une votation sur une question d'armée en Suisse. Enfin, donc une votation contre l'armée, entre guillemets. Donc c'est plutôt sur des thèmes très précis. Enfin, aussi sur la politique migratoire, par exemple, on est les seuls. Même le Parti Socialiste qui va mieux qu'en France, c'est pas très difficile, me direz-vous non plus, mais donc on a un Parti Socialiste qui est fort en Suisse, mais qui a des positions plus centristes que les Verts. Nous, on se positionne clairement à la gauche de ce Parti Socialiste, mais comme je vous disais avant, on essaye vraiment de ne pas faire de populisme. Au contraire, je pense qu'on est des fois un peu trop intello, mais on préfère avoir des réponses vraiment argumentées, même si elles sont complexes, plutôt que d'aller dans le simplisme à tout prix. Pour ce qui est maintenant de l'homogénéité dans la direction, les luttes de chapelle, etc., oui, ça existe aussi chez nous, très clairement. D'ailleurs, quand on a eu une défaite électorale en 2011, la première, les Verts avaient eu 10 ans de croissance quasi ininterrompue. En 2011, on perd les élections, on perd plusieurs sièges au Parlement fédéral. Et beaucoup de gens commencent à dire au sein du parti « Ah, ça va pas, c'est parce qu'on est trop positionné à gauche. » Le président de l'époque était effectivement très à gauche, avait un discours très offensif, plus social, disaient ses détracteurs, qu'écologiste, vraiment. Et donc, il y a eu effectivement des luttes intestines au sein du parti. Mais ce qui sauve, entre guillemets, les Verts suisses, c'est que le parti fédéral, donc le parti suisse, a relativement peu de pouvoir et d'influence par rapport aux partis cantonaux, qui sont ceux qui font vraiment la politique sur le terrain, qui présentent les candidats, etc. Et donc on a quand même toujours réussi à avoir une certaine cohésion, malgré les luttes qui existent. Le parti des Verts vaudois, qui est le mien, du canton de Vaud, est né de l'union de deux partis, un qui était clairement d'extrême gauche, un autre qui était plus transcentriste, et aujourd'hui encore, les gens ne sont pas toujours d'accord entre eux, mais on arrive toujours quand même à trouver un consensus. Donc oui, ça existe, mais on arrive à dépasser cela aussi parce qu'il y a un pouvoir qui est peut-être plus diffus que dans d'autres partis. Et ça m'arrive, j'arrive du coup à la dernière question qui était celle de la stratégie des candidats. Nous, on a très 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 peu de personnalisation de la politique. C'est pas le cas de tous les partis, mais de manière générale, il y a peu de personnalisation de la politique en Suisse. Et chez les Verts, c'est encore plus fort. On essaye vraiment, surtout en Suisse romande, donc la partie francophone, mais plus généralement un peu partout, de mettre en avant les idées plutôt que les candidats. Donc on n'a pas un leader ou un ou des leaders qu'on met vraiment en avant, etc. En plus, c'est une élection à la proportionnelle, donc on vote une liste et pas une personne. Et partant de là, on a pas vraiment ce problème de devoir choisir des leaders ou autres. On l'a un petit peu parce qu'on a une partie, c'est un système électoral qui est un peu complexe, on a une partie du système qui est la majoritaire, donc là, on personnalise un petit peu plus l'élection, mais sinon, on essaie vraiment d'axer les campagnes sur les thèmes plutôt que sur les personnes. Et d'ailleurs, par exemple, on a une règle dans la plupart des partis verts des sections locales qui est celle de jamais appeler à voter pour soi, mais à toujours, les candidats doivent dire voter pour moi, mais voter pour la liste verte. Donc ça, c'est très important. Alors, c'est pas toujours évident, et on se rend compte qu'on a de plus en plus une volonté chez les candidats, pas chez les militants, mais chez les candidats de personnalisation, parce que les gens veulent être élus, forcément. Mais on résiste pour le moment, et ce qui est important, c'est de faire passer les idées vertes, et pas faire élire telle ou telle personne.
On va refaire un tour, mais je pense qu'on n'aura pas le temps d'en faire. So, take four this time, and then. So, we have someone there for a long time. Can't we? Je ne vais pas tous réussir à vous prendre, je suis désolée, ça va faire trop long.
I was wondering, you were all at the time experiencing difficulties, and from what I get in quite a short time recovery, I was wondering how did you implement all the tasks of researches, of building a brand and implementing new tools with low resources at a time and low financial and human resources.
Merci encore pour... moi, j'ai appris plein de choses et ça fait du bien d'entendre des choses constructives de temps en temps. Alors, il y avait deux questions. Je vous ai beaucoup entendu parler du fait qu'il fallait qu'on apprenne à ne plus critiquer les autres, être dans la critique de ce que faisaient les autres, mais développer notre propre marque et notre particularité. Du coup, cette question de devoir systématiquement se positionner sur un axe droite-gauche, après, ça peut dépendre des pays et des modes de scrutin de chaque pays. Mais est-ce que globalement, sur les verts européens, est-ce qu'aujourd'hui c'est un avantage de marque d'avoir à se positionner sur des échelles de marque qui ne correspondent pas forcément à ce qu'on défend? Ça, c'était la première question. Et la deuxième, c'est sur les autres partis européens, quelle est la part de fédéralisme dans l'organisation interne des partis? Et en expérience, est-ce que, en effet, les petites luttes internes et les capacités à développer une stratégie qui suive derrière, est-ce qu'une organisation fédéraliste peut l'aider ou plutôt la desservir?
On va prendre là-bas, Morgan, at the end, because he's been... Yeah.
Merci beaucoup. J'ai une question très très simple. En France, on n'a pas du tout la culture du consensus. C'est peut-être une grosse différence avec tout ce que vous avez dit. Comment vous faites pour éviter que la guerre des égos finisse toujours dans la presse?
And the last one there, and then we will give answers. So if you've not understood that at the moment this party is in crisis and has internal problems...
moi, je voulais juste poser une question sur l'agenda médiatique. Vous nous avez parlé de thèmes, de stratégie de campagne, de thèmes. Mais comment votre candidat arrive à imposer un agenda médiatique, sachant qu'il va y avoir des affaires, il va y avoir des crises. Là, on a sur les crises sanitaires et les crises agricoles. On a toujours des crises qui viennent de toute l'Europe. Et pareil, on a toujours des... Je veux dire, ça prend une part importante du message des politiques. Et quand vous... Vos stratégies s'intercalent par rapport à cet agenda.
So, low resources, how do you do with low resources? Because you always started at a moment where you were not very wealthy. We had the question about decentralized governance. Do you have more decentralized governance or not? And also, how is it an advantage or a handicap to have to be somewhere on the left or somewhere on the right? Do you have that problem? The third one was about how do you get your internal problems not in the press, which is a problem we French encounter a lot. So that's why you had the question. And the fourth question was about how do you react on your agenda that you have well planned to things that have just come up like that, pop up?
Now I forgot all of them, of course. So I'll just start with the last one. You have to focus on your own agenda first and foremost. And there, of course, during campaigns, you have all these issues coming up. And some of those crises you can use. And then you think well about how can we respond from our own values and characteristics that we want to show to the people. And if you see possibilities, use it. And otherwise, just stay away from it. It's only airtime that you spend on things that you don't want to spend it on. But most of the crises that you mentioned, I think, fit perfectly in a green agenda. Then concerning fights, I know the French really do like their fights in the party. And that's a real shame, because you see where it ended up at this moment in France, because it ended up with absolutely nothing in all terms you can imagine. So stop it. I mean, that's basically what is the best solution. I really, 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 really don't understand that you are publicly fighting each other if you have power in this country, which is about this big. Because you will never ever get more voters if you are fighting. I mean, if you go to a birthday party, I don't know how that works in French, but I do think you go to the birthday party of people that are actually having a good time. I'm pretty sure. But if it's otherwise, if you go to the birthday party where, you know, there's going to be a big fight, I'm going, you know, then it might work. No, but seriously, I mean, we of course had the same problem when we were doing that bad. But we really managed to keep, but not to keep everyone indoors. We had a lot of people that left the party. We were slamming doors and opinion articles in the newspapers and interviews on television, and all of them returned after the elections because they all thought they could become a minister. But it is really important, therefore, again, to do research, because the research just is objective and it shows you what you should do to get into power, and that's what you basically want to do as a party. Now, I believe the French don't do that much research, and you can do it quite easy, because you can already collect supporters, their email addresses, and start up your own opinion polls and just see how people respond to your messages. So I would really recommend that, and leave the fights at home. Well, don't fight at all, that's even better.
Resources, that's an
important thing. That question came from there, I think. We have 15 million inhabitants in the Netherlands, and we lost 60% of our seats and employees in 2012. And we were already not that really, really big. So we were very, very tight on budget. We had €350,000 in total for the whole campaign. We spent lots of it on research, and we spent a lot of it on Facebook. We didn't do TV ads, we didn't do radio ads, we didn't do I don't know how many different posters, we didn't hand out I don't know how many jackets, we didn't do a bus tour because we couldn't afford it. I mean, we really focused on online campaigning and on getting this engagement of supporters. So we had many volunteers. We had all our apps built by volunteers. We had a group of 100 people that work in social media and IT who helped us out to build the apps, to build all those build all that content. And it only cost us a couple of pizzas and some beers, well, quite a lot of beers actually, but then still it was cheaper. And then there was one more question.
Decentralized. How is your party decentralized or not?
Well, I mean, of course, in every party you have many different people with different powers, because they have, I mean, for example, if you're a party leader in Amsterdam, you're a lot more important than if you're in a small village, or at least they think they are. Indeed, you have those fights within the party. But then again, it's with research and strategy is usually the solution to any problem. And the strategy should be clear. And the strategy is you want to win seats. That's your goal. And that's where you start, with anyone who has a problem. And then we have we work with Slack. I explained it this morning, so I might repeat myself a little bit for some. But it's a communication system, and that's the only system that we use with all our politicians. If you're in a small village or in the national parliament, if you want to know what's going on, that's the channel. And you have all these different channels in there with a different hierarchy. And if there's a problem somewhere in a small village, it will go up, until it's really necessary that, for example, I call them and I say, listen, why is this problem? And why are you writing this in a newspaper, whatever? And we can have a discussion. Can we invite you to come over to wherever and have a chat about it? And that way, that was a really good solution to get all these different opinions aligned. So there's a group of the 20 biggest cities. There's a group of you can think of anything. And I guess that would also be quite good in France. Of course, distances are really big. And if you have a system like that where you can communicate, you can really solve problems quite quickly.
Okay, the first thing, I can't really talk about the resources, because we had quite good resources compared to what you had, for example. But what you have to do, I guess, is look at others and look where what successful progressive parties do and copy it. At least we all looked at the Obama campaign in terms of innovation, really big step for progressives. The question about the left and right system, and if we talk about if we say we should more talk about us, is it still necessary, the system? I think call it progressive, call it left, but still that's in the center of our values, the hope versus fear, the care versus security thing. It's progressive and still.
Do you need to use the term left, or do you don't use it? You just say you're green, and it's by the value. That you showed that you left.
I don't think that you win votes for using the term left or progressive. I think you win the votes for your values. In some parts of the society, it might be the people sum up those values under the term left. So perhaps it's sometimes makes sense to use it. Yeah. We are a decentralized party in terms of the strong regions in Austria. But there wasn't, but these reforms weren't, the conflict wasn't going between the different regions, but between more open and more conservative party members. So there's always some party members that say we always did that this way, and they don't see that it doesn't work anymore, and there are other members who are willing to try something else. Yeah, that's the line, not the regional line. Attention on internal fight. If you have internal fight, and I can tell you we have a lot of internal fight at the moment, then you can't get away the intention. That's you have to end it. that's what I would have to say. Then the question with the crisis and how do you get your message through? I would say if you can communicate in your values within your brand, then address it. And we have a saying in Austria that I hope I can translate. You don't have to grab every shit that runs down the river. So leave it if you don't.
If it doesn't fit your agenda.
If it's not your agenda, yeah.
Okay, thanks. Go on, Emma.
Okay, I tried to answer briefly. About the left or right discussion, actually in Finland we want to think ourselves that we are something else than left or right or center, that we are actually more like members of the Green Party can have very, very different views of politics, but the values are something that we share, and the values are the ones that makes the politics. And by that, what I said, I mean that we want to see ourselves more progressive, and the ones that are offering new solutions instead of putting ourselves in one wing or another. That is actually quite a traditional way of seeing parties. What else? About that a message, then, when in society there are many things happening all the time, in news there are things that some of these things concern us and some of them don't. But in our strategy, we decided to talk about things that people find important. For example, in Finland during recession, all the parties were talking about jobs and employment and the ways that people can, the ways that we could create jobs. For example, our solutions was that first we need basic income, so that everyone has better opportunities to have their income like in a less traditional way, that because we have very outdated social security. So we wanted to talk about social security, I mean in a way of basic income. And the other thing was that we offered ideas how to create jobs in the sector of renewable energy. In this way, we we combined our agenda, that was renewable energy, and the thing that everyone else is discussing about, that is jobs and employment. We wanted to be a part of the discussion that is going on in the society, what people may think they are important. So we offered our solutions and we combined our values and our agenda to the things that are going on in the society.
Alors, peut-être sur le positionnement gauche-droite, tout d'abord. Ce qui est intéressant, c'est que ben, je reviens toujours à cette question du fédéralisme et du fait que tout soit très décentralisé. La question ne se pose pas vraiment dans le sens où il y a autant de réponses qu'il y a de listes et de cantons dans lesquels on les présente. Il y a des cantons dans lesquels les Verts se présentent sur la même liste avec l'équivalent du Parti communiste, par exemple, et dans d'autres où ils font des alliances plutôt avec des partis du centre. Mais quand même, on a un peu en filigrane toujours le débat gauche-droite avec des gens qui disent « Mais au final, on n'est ni de gauche ni de droite. Nous, ce qui nous importe, c'est l'écologie et il faut sortir du schéma de la révolution industrielle, enfin gauche-droite. D'une société post-industrielle, il ne faut plus réfléchir comme ça. » Mais ce débat, heureusement, à mon sens en tout cas, il est en train un petit peu de perdre de l'ampleur chez les Verts. Et aujourd'hui, on est clairement... Ce qui est paradoxal, en fait, c'est que les études montrent que nos militants et nos élus sont très clairement positionnés très à gauche. La ligne du parti est très à gauche. Mais l'électeur type des Verts croit voter pour un parti plutôt centriste. C'est assez paradoxal, mais c'est comme ça. L'électeur type des Verts est quelqu'un qui n'est pas spécialement... à gauche, qui s'intéresse plutôt au thème d'écologie, enfin qui est même plutôt centriste, mais ça ne se reflète pas dans les militants, dans les positionnements du parti, ni dans les positions des élus dans les parlements, par exemple. La question du fédéralisme, elle est effectivement, je pense, très 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 importante pour nous. Ça nous aide à garder une certaine cohésion et d'être le plus proche possible du terrain. On a vraiment un système très capillaire qui fait qu'on est... Il y a ça et la question aussi de la proportionnelle. Le système électoral proportionnel qui s'applique partout en Suisse fait que dans n'importe quelle commune, dans n'importe quel canton, donc l'équivalent du département, et au Parlement fédéral, on est bien représenté parce que on fait grosse maille entre 10 et 15% des voix selon les endroits. Et avec ces résultats-là, avec une majoritaire, vous n'avez aucune chance en gros d'être placé nulle part. Dans une proportionnelle, vous avez un certain nombre d'élus et on a aujourd'hui des Verts qui font partie de majorités dans des parlements un petit peu partout. Pour ce qui est des ressources maintenant, ça a été effectivement difficile pour les Verts suisses. En 2011, faut savoir que on a relativement peu d'argent qui vient de l'État. Il n'y a pas de financement public des partis en Suisse. Si ce n'est un tout petit peu par rapport pour financer le groupe parlementaire, enfin le secrétaire des groupes parlementaires, mais vraiment le gros de l'argent des partis vient soit de privés, notamment les partis de droite se font énormément financer par des entreprises, soit par les rétrocessions des élus qui reversent aux partis une partie de l'argent qu'ils gagnent dans leur travail d'élu. Et en ayant perdu plusieurs sièges, on a dû malheureusement licencier des personnes. Enfin, ça a été très difficile. Mais on s'en est sorti, on a fait tout un programme d'économie relativement important, et au final, la roue tourne. Mais c'est vrai que quand on est très dépendant du nombre d'élus, c'est particulièrement difficile de continuer à tourner dans une situation où on perd des sièges. On a fait un budget avec X sièges, si on en perd, c'est clair que les ressources financières diminuent. Dernière chose, c'était celle des combats intestins et de comment ne pas les faire sortir dans la presse. Je pense que c'est impossible. Ça arrivait aussi en Suisse, au niveau local également. Du moment que des personnes ne sont pas d'accord, qu'il y a des frustrations, il y a toujours des personnes qui pensent que le meilleur moyen de se faire entendre, c'est passer par les médias. Mais je pense que la réponse à cela, c'est de moins personnaliser la politique. Si ce qui est prépondérant et prédominant, c'est les idées du parti, de savoir que truc ou machin ou tel et tel n'est pas content puisqu'il n'a pas été mis à telle place sur la liste ou qu'il aurait voulu être ailleurs, à ce moment-là, ça a moins d'intérêt, je pense. Et la toute dernière chose que je voulais vous dire, c'est que vous êtes quand même vu les Verts français comme avec beaucoup d'attention et de sympathie en Suisse romande de la partie francophone de la Suisse, avec beaucoup d'admiration aussi pour ce qui a été fait. Et moi, je suis vraiment convaincu qu'il y a une place pour l'écologie politique en France et que ça ne peut que aller mieux, que vous allez regagner le terrain qui est perdu, parce que vous le méritez.